So, hello everybody. For whoever has not met me yet, I'm Vincenzo. And today I'm here for discussing about a meta-analysis with you and to see how these techniques can be applied on the omics data. Before starting, I would like to thank David, Navarrabiomed, and all the Spanish team that is working so hard for us. So, but we are short in time today, so let's start immediately. This is the outline of the presentation. First, I wanted to discuss about what is meta-analysis, why we are going to spend 2 hours talking about this, and how it can be useful for us. Then we are going directly to see some of the techniques that are used in meta-analysis and how these are used in omics data. And then we're also going to talk about the connection between meta-analysis and batch effect removal, another area often used in omics that is actually strictly related. These two are strictly related, and we will see how. So, first things first. So let's start with the definition scope of meta-analysis. What is the perfect meta-analysis?
Performing a study in Austria, in Spain, a bit from Florida. You collect some molecular data, some DNA space, or some metabolomics, or whatever the type of measurement you want to collect. And after that, everybody can hear me, it's okay. And after that, you essentially replicate the same identical study, also in another positive state, maybe in Madrid or somewhere else. And you do this multiple times, so again, you have multiple studies. Multiple studies that they are essentially studying the same hypothesis. That can be how gene expression affects some type of disease, for example. They have the same study design. And they are performing all different samples. And so now the question is, I may get a different information or different results from each study. For example, in a study, it can be that the odds ratio of the disease given a certain mutation is 0 to 2. In another study, the same odds ratio is 0 to 4. So now, what is the reality? What is the truth, the true effect? And this is what I want to ask. So this is, let's say, the scope of meta-analysis. Essentially, we are measuring different studies in order to have a better estimation of the effects we are studying. And these are the usual settings. I would like to ask you right now, out of these settings, which one, in your opinion, is more likely to not be respected when we do some analysis on omics data, for example? Okay, multiple studies for sure. There are so many studies about gene space, for example. This is by design. I mean, we do choose also this one by design. Independent samples is problematic. One thing that we don't know, for example, is if the same measurements will be on the studies, because if you are using NGS, you may have or not the same genes, for example. If you are using targeted metabolomics, I mean, good luck in identifying that the same features measured in a study are also measured in another study. So, essentially, what happens is that the meta-analysis methods must be tailored in order to suit the needs of the data you are using. Depending by the data, you have to modify or apply in a different way the meta-analysis. Before going to the techniques, to the analytical techniques, I would like just to spend 1 minute on these slides. If you are ever going to make a meta-analysis study, actually, you are going to spend 90% of the time on all these things. This is actually the most important slide of the whole presentation. We are going to spend 2 minutes on this. We are going to spend 28 minutes on the other one, but this is the most important one. So essentially, what happens is the following. If you want to do some data analysis, you must have multiple studies. You must choose them, select them. You must be sure that the data is correct. And this is not easy at all. Depending on what you want to do, it may be the case that you have to scrutinize thousands of articles. Or maybe on the other way around, it may be the case that you are trying to study something that is so rare, and then you have only few studies. And then it's kind of difficult to identify them. But in any case, what you have to do here, this is the most important part of the meta-analysis, because you must devise an algorithm so that you can essentially you can essentially be sure that whatever studies you get in, whatever data you are getting in, these are from studies that are comparable, homogeneous among each other. This is the step that we follow in a paper we published in 2016. And this is a real number. I mean, at the beginning we were considering 4,000 studies. Then most of them we could just eliminate them just looking at the title in the same automatic way. But nevertheless, then we had 400 articles to read. We were four people, five, still. I mean, you have to read all these papers and to be sure that you can actually summarize this one. In this other paper here back in 2015, here we tried to make a meta-analysis. We failed, because at the end we realized that for all these studies that we were collecting, we couldn't collect all the data we wanted. And so we end up actually making a review. The review paper is also a possibility. But nevertheless, in both cases, this phase took us months, while the real analysis took something like weeks. So keep this in mind. And a very good guide for this is actually the Cochrane handbook. If you go on this website, you are going to have in front of you a pure 90s interface. This website was made, I think, in the 90s, it's still the same, but the information that was written back then is absolutely useful to them. So this is pretty much cartoonish representation of the analysis. I hope you forgive me for this. It's actually a part of one paper of mine. And essentially here what we have is that we have different data with different sample size. And the data sets, even if they must be as homogeneous as possible, they can still have some slightly different characteristics. Like for example, you may have that the type of protocol or can be slightly different among each other. It is still okay if you record all of this, and then we'll see how you can use that. So out of each data set, you compute some type of statistics. Then you merge the statistics with some method. This is what we're going to discuss now. And at the end, you have a summarized statistic in order to answer your question, whatever it is. So right now, we are going to focus on this part, and we are going to see all the possible approaches. Starting from the one that looks like the simplest one, the rank aggregation methods. Anybody knows something about this type of methods, or about any of these methods that are represented here? No? You are all shy, or? I mean, it is not an interrogation. I'm not going to put any mark on you or anything else. You can reply. It's okay. Okay, good. Anyway, let's go one by one, this means. So here I use just a very simple example about what the rank aggregation is. Let's say I have the two data sets, that's the one that is two. These are just the expression data sets. And for each gene, I just compute a p-value to check how different the express is. This is extremely easy, straightforward, pretty much plain technique. What I can do is just to say, okay, with this data set, this gene here, particularly, looks like the most recent dependency expressed one. So I will just give him a rank 1. This one is the second most expressed one, so rank 2 and so on. And I'm going to have all my ranks. And the same we'll do with the second data set. I'm presenting this for gene expression data. Of course, you can do this with whatever type of study where you have multiple elements to rank. And that actually, the higher the number of elements to rank, the better it is. So once you have made this transformation in rankings, then you can actually combine these rankings in pretty much in different ways. One way that they actually pretty much use quite a lot is the product. And so then you have the product of the ranks. But you can also use the mean of the sum, which is actually about the same. And so if you use the product, what happens is that whatever has a low number here is actually the most interesting gene for the sums. Whatever has a higher rank is something that actually was not relevant in any of the studies. The same things were here. So these are actually the two most, the simplest methods for rank aggregation. If you want to read more about rank aggregation, actually there are several other methods that are much more complicated. And there are several other methods because here we just present a vanilla case, but several other things can happen. For example, it may be the case that not in all studies you have exactly the same measurements, so you have only overlapping measurements. So for the same measurement, maybe it's present in two studies, and then you have another measurement that is present in eight. How do you compare the ranks? And so in this case, you may want, for example, to use some Bayes approach, where you have some trial on the possible rank of an element. This actually is a figure taken by a pretty much nice review paper. And so I would really suggest you to read this, though the references are actually at the end of the presentation, so you don't have them. And then depending by what is your problem, you can actually use one of these methods. Supervised is something that pretty much is never used because it's supposed that you have a training set that you can use in order to learn how to rank your elements. It's pretty much in common. In the unsupervised, then you can have discrepancies, that is what we saw before. And then the rank pro, the rank sum are all here, non-parametric. You can have some optimization base if you are trying actually to find an optimal rank that is the closest to all the other ranks. And so in different orders methods. An important thing is the following. Okay, I can get a aggregate rank. I mean, I can label my zine, for example, with a rank that says, for me, this is the zine number 8 in order of difference expression. But can also attach a p-value to that? The answer in general is yes, almost, but practically always yes, because in the worst case, we always have a computation-based method. And then for some of the methods, there are some close for the common expression, meaning some parametric way to compute a value. We are going to see this later on in the, with the code. Some cosmic things, which are pretty much simple, intuitive. This is what is instead a drawback. It's something very subtle, meaning that the rank tells you nothing with respect to the actual biological relevance of the result. Going back again to the example of the difference expressed gene, your first gene maybe is the first one referred to the other one, but if all your results are practically random, then what you have is that the first one is there just by chance, I mean, it tells you nothing. Maybe it's the effect size, the local change is not relevant at all. So rank methods, we are going to see this again in the code, must be used with caution because you must understand exactly what you're doing here. We are going to see this better later. So we saw the Navarrabiomed method now. Let's go and see an even easier method, let's say. So, this was a method that, again, we used in the paper with Dovia, that we published in 2016. It was actually the figure one of the paper. Let me give you some background about this paper. Actually, this paper started in the last STATegra summer school, in that this guy here was one of the students, and then essentially we start talking about meta-analysis. He was already conducting some studies, and we end up making a paper. I don't know if David knew about this.
Yeah.
Anyway, so this actually was a paper that came out from this summer school, from the So now in the following, this was one of the first meta-analysis studies about untargeted metabolomics in cancer. So what we did here was to collect, remember now how many studies, if you have this, maybe you can be correct, where here every single column is one study. And for each study, we were reporting which metabolite were identified as relevant between cancer tissue and normal tissue or in blood. So as you can see, the map is very sparse. because every single study was reporting their own metabolites. There are a few metabolites reported everywhere. There are a few studies reporting a lot of metabolites, but then the rest is pretty much sparse. So how to make here a meta-analysis? It was pretty much difficult. That's what we say, since we have so scarce information, it's better to use the most, actually the simplest method. Have you used what count, meaning that we built this matrix, I mean, we built this matrix exactly null, it looked like a R matrix. We assign minus one every time the metabolite was reported down, regulated, and plus one every time the metabolite was upregulated, and we just made a thing. We were just summing the rules. And this is what we got here. It is actually, this tells you that, for example, tryptophan is very down-regulated using cancer. It's also significant. And so up to, sorry guys, I don't know what it is. Glutamic acid, that is actually pretty much often upregulated. And so these are just both counted. Nothing else is literally summing the votes. But we have one for upregulation, plus one for downregulation. Yeah, it's a simple method, but unfortunately, you know, discards a lot of information. However, it's okay when you don't have this information, because in most of those studies, there was actually no information at all about FSI or all the information like this. So, now we go to something a little bit more complicated. How do you mean that? Let me just speed up. Now we go to something a little bit more complicated with some mathematical formula. I hope you forgive me since it's 4:30 in the evening after a long day. So essentially these are fixed and effects models. Actually they are pretty nice because they do use a lot of information coming from effect size and variance. And they are heavily inspired by the mixed linear models. Anybody has some know what these are? Mixed linear models? So, let's start with something, again, simple. Let's have an intuitive explanation about these type of models. So, you make a study. I borrowed this notation from this paper here. It's a paper that was cited thousands of times, and actually it's a paper that described the metaphor package of R. And it's published in Journal of Statistical Software. It's an excellent paper. If you can have a look at this, and this explains extremely well whatever we need to know about the fixed and random and random effects model. Anyway, so you made the study, and you computed that, for example, that the odds ratio of a disease with respect to a disease mutation is y sub 1, whatever this number is, 0.4, whatever, doesn't matter. However, since this is a study on a finite number of samples, you know that actually what you estimate here is just an estimate. So there is probably a true effect that you probably missed, and what you estimate was just essentially something close to it, and how much close is somehow dictated by the variance of your study. Are we cool with that? And again, this is the meta-analysis, what you do is to take this study and to replicate it several times. So now if I have y sub 1, y sub 2, y sub 3 that I know, these are my numbers. I have v sub 1, v sub 2, v sub 3 that I also know, these are all numbers. What I don't know are the three numbers. But at least now I have this, this information. We have also an assumption. The assumption is that actually what I measured is essentially measured, it's an estimate of the true effect with a normal random noise. It can be a reasonable assumption or not, depends by what you are studying. To make it short, essentially once I have something like this, I can use this number in order to compute an average two effect. Meaning that I have all the studies, I know my estimate for each single study, I know how accurate is the measurement. And so what I can do, I can actually use some weighted least square in order to get a weighted average. And since what I do, I take all my estimate, and I just make an average, but I weight the average by the inverse of the open lines. Why this? Because this essentially means the more the study is uncertain, the less I want to count it in my estimates. How bad is this? Anybody explain that? Okay, perfect. You can also do an even less accurate estimation, that's taking the mean. And these are actually the fixed models. So in the fixed model, the only assumption that I have is this one, that can be less or not. And I just have a multiple study with their variance and their estimates. Now we go to the random effect models. The random effect models, I say, okay, I have these three studies, but this is not that much of a rare disease, for example. It's not something so complicated to study. So I'm sure that there are many more studies like this in the world. And so then what I want to do now is to realize that actually these three studies are essentially samples, are essentially just three instances of a much larger population of possible studies. And this means that I will have one more assumption, and then I will try to model also the population of my studies. So every single study models its own small population. All studies together, when you put them together, model a larger population of studies. It's like meta-analysis. An analysis study is a study, a meta-analysis study is a set of studies. If you repeat this time, this thing 100 times very fast, you're pretty good. So, one thing that I don't like of random effect models is that then essentially you have like one more primary assumption. Because you, essentially you are saying that in your opinion, the distribution of the studies can be modeled with a normal distribution. This can be true or false, it depends. And you cannot have actually a way. It's very difficult. It's not so easy to understand whether this assumption holds or not. And when we have, and what we want to estimate now from this distribution is actually mean, that is the true effect, and tau squared. That is the variance across the studies. And this means actually that this element here, in the language of the linear models, is called random effect. But I don't want to go into this element. So the most important thing to remember about fixed effect and random effect is the following, that for fixed effect, you only model the studies you have. You don't make any assumption on any other possible study. For the random effects, you actually make some assumptions on all possible studies. And so you can also model studies that will be done in the future, for example. This is the most important thing to remember about these two approaches. So when you have a random effect, the first thing you do is to estimate that. There are several formulas to do that. The formulas usually are too long to fit in the slide, so I didn't put them. But you, again, you can find it in the journal statistics software paper that I studied also before. Or better, you can find here the reference to those formulas. And then, mean is how to estimate when you solve all the questions with the assumption we say. Mean is estimating the formula is very close to what we saw for the fixed effects. Just that in this case, you inflate the variance of the study by the by that computer across all studies. So how is it going here? Any questions about this? Well, my first question to make, for example, is the following. When should I choose the fixed effect when the random? If you have enough studies, you should always choose random effect. For a simple fact that this will give you more information. if you have very few studies, 2, 3, 4, there is not much point in making in studying the variance. Because at the end of the day, the random effects actually study the variance of across studies. So if you have 2 studies, how can you study the, how can you estimate the variance between 2 points? There is no point at all. Also, there are some statistical tests, even if they are not very powerful, that can tell you whether tax score is developed from 0 or not, meaning how heterogeneous are your studies, one across the other one. Actually, if they are very heterogeneous, you should start questioning your collection, meaning, did I collect the right data? Maybe there is something wrong. One important thing here, that when you use the fixer, both fixer and the random effect, you can actually include some information about the studies in order to have even better estimate. What I mean, for example, is that let's say you make 1 study in Pamplona and 1 in Cadiz. Cadiz? How do you pronounce it? Cadiz? Okay. 1 in Pamplona and 1 in Cadiz. And you know that for the study you have done, the average temperature is actually a factor. And so, when you use this type of models, you can actually include the average temperature of the place as a coverage in your model in order to take this into account. So essentially, these models here, they allow you also to factor in peculiarities, characteristics of the existing study. Essentially, what you're going to do would be a regression over the characteristics of the study. What I don't like is, of course, that there are some particular assumptions that you add on top of it. If they hold okay, if they don't hold, it's you may have a problem. Yes, we are almost at the end of the presentation. The code will be much worse, so enjoy with these last few minutes. So let's go to the summarization of the p-values. So these are pretty much famous methods, but let's recapitulate them nevertheless. So essentially, again, if I have a different studies, this means that most probably I also have different values. So for example, I may have a study that depends the expression of the Icarus gene in 4 different studies, one made in New York, one made in Minnesota, and so on. And for each one of the study, I have a 1 p-value telling me how much the gene was expressed. Again, the p-values come from the seminal hypothesis. The p-values are independent, meaning that they were measured on different samples. Now I want to combine them. Why I want to combine the values? Because by combining them, I may actually get some more statistical power, which is something pretty much convenient in many cases. So, Fischer, in 1932, so almost 1 century ago, actually many of the methods we are seeing now actually are pretty much old, but nevertheless they come back pretty much useful, of course, for our slides now. Came out with this formula, where essentially said that if these assumptions are expected, you can easily combine the p-value by taking it, by summing their logarithm value. And this positive here will be distributed as a p-square, and so then you can have a statistical test here in order to have a global p-value. And the global p-value tells you whether all the null hypotheses are true. Meaning that, the final statistical test I can do on this statistic tells me whether these p-values jointly considered, whether they allow me, considered jointly, to say that Icarus is defense expressed or not. And there are several formulas like this. This is just one of the several. We see also the Stauffer formula, the Stauffer-Lipp test is actually the same. Then there is the Tippett formula, and so on. And in general, you can combine the values in this way, or with other formulas, in order to gain some detail power. It's a simple method. If you need the values, use directly another kind of p-value that is a summary statistics. Unfortunately, each combination method depends upon some assumptions. And one thing that actually my previous supervisor and his postdoc found out is that you can have a very biased results if you are using arbitrary values. But this is another story. It's a technicality. It's important to know, but it's a technicality. So we're almost done here with the presentation. These are essentially some pretty much known and widely used methods for meta-analysis. The first two are pretty much non-parametric. They can be used pretty much always. The other two is that they have some more assumptions than parametric, so you have to be careful about this. And now I'd like to talk about the budget methods. Actually, I'm not going to go into details of this method here. Essentially, what happens here is the following, that for batch effect remover, what happens is that you assume you have a data set, and you assume that inside this data set, you have essentially difference in distribution across the sample. Meaning that, let's say you have a data set with, 1,000 samples, and you assume that not only these 1,000 samples are homogeneous, but there are sample populations. And so then you want to adjust for this difference in the multivariate distribution. And there are methods for doing this. This one is actually the one that was developed by the lab of Anna Conesa. Also, someone was working on this. And these are the two methods that are also pretty much known for these things. So what is the difference here is the following. In the meta-analysis approach, what I do is take my three data sets, or n data sets, analyze them in isolation, one by one. I compute my statistics, and then I merge my statistics. This is what we discussed until now. If this is new to you, something went wrong in the last half an hour. In the data merge approach, instead, what I do, I take the three data sets, I merge them together. I stack them. I mean, in R, you will just do a R by. Then I correct with some method whatever difference distribution I have, and what I got at the end is a big data set. And then I do the analysis on the big data set and I get the statistic. But at the end of the day, both approaches, they give you essentially some final statistics about whatever you study. So, there are not much comparative analysis about these two approaches. One was done by me in my political course in 2016. And essentially, even if there are some differences within each class of methods, the two types of methods, at least in our comparison, were pretty much working, were giving pretty much the same performance. This means that you can use whatever approach you prefer or is more suitable for you. Any question?
About the last point that you showed to us, sometimes you cannot merge data because maybe some studies have their own already summarized the statistics and maybe there are some complaints about merging data and so on. But what is the effect of having different sizes in each, you have three studies with different size, one sample size, and you do separately, and then you do the meta-analysis, and if you can merge it, you have everything together.
Yeah.
And that, I guess that everything together, you have more power, because you have more. So, is there any bias there?
Of course there is bias, because essentially what will happen is that the bigger data set will probably influence more the results. But this will happen also for the meta-analysis, most probably, because bigger data most probably will have a lower variance. And so, especially if you use something like XM effect method or random effect method, then you're going to have this one weighting more. And up to some point, it's also something that you want, because if all the studies have the same quality, so in a comparable amount of noise, then yes, you do want this, that the larger study influence more. However, talking about that, we will see this on the code, there is also something called sensitivity analysis, meaning that you repeat the whole process by taking, for example, one data set out of the time. If the results are dramatically different, then you know that the data set actually influence your results. Other question?